Hello everyone, I hope all of you are doing fine. In today's video, I'll talk about two major hyperparameters of SVM, that is C and Gamma. So without wasting any further time, let's kickstart the video. But hey, hold on, it would be super motivating if you can press the subscribe button and also press the bell icon to be notified for amazing videos on data science and machine learning. Assuming that you've already subscribed, let's kickstart the video. In today's video, I'll show you using code how different values of hyperparameters impact our classification boundary. But before we do that, I just wanted to lay the foundations right. Support vector machine, as you know, is a classification algorithm that aims at creating a larger margin between two classes, say assuming class 1 and class 0. And also to lower down the misclassification or error rate once the margin is created. So this is the whole crux of how support vector machines work. Now the two hyperparameters in SVM that I'll talk about in today's video are gamma and C. Now the gamma parameter comes in handy when you're using kernels like RBF or Poly. It does not have any role to play when your kernel is linear in nature. Now what exactly does it do? Well, gamma essentially controls the distance of influence of a single training point. What do I mean by that? Well, low values of gamma indicate that a large similarity radius is required, which results in more points being grouped together. For higher values of gamma, the points need to be very close to each other in order to be considered as the same group. All of this will kind of make sense once I kind of go through a visualization on this. Let's kickstart the SVM hyperparameter visualization activity by importing the necessary modules. So let me run the cell. Now that the imports are complete, let's go forward. In order to create appealing visualizations, the next thing that I do is I create listed color maps, not one, but two of them. The first one is what I'll utilize while plotting a scatter plot. The second one will be utilized for plotting the decision boundary. Class 0 points would be denoted by the red color. Class 1 points would be denoted by the color green. If this idea is clear to you, let's go forward. This piece of code is what I'll utilize for plotting the decision boundary. This function that I've created, which is generate_CLF, it accepts two parameters, input_gamma and input_C. In this function, essentially, I create a classifier, I fit my training data, that is X and Y, and I make a prediction and I calculate the accuracy. Once the accuracy is calculated, I return the classifier from the function. So let me go forward and run this cell. The next thing that I do is I call the make_classification function and I generate 200 samples with two features, that is x1 and x2 and one target variable y. So let me run this cell. Let me now go forward and show you the scatter plot of our data set. So let me run the cell. So as you can clearly see, the red points signify the class 0 samples and the green points signify the class 1 samples. Let's go forward. As I've already mentioned, gamma parameter essentially controls the distance of influence of a single training point. Low values of gamma indicate a large similarity radius, which results in more points being grouped together. So whatever I've just mentioned is what I'll try to explain using some visualizations. Let me start off by creating the first classifier with a gamma value of 0.001. So let me run the cell. So the training accuracy comes out to be around 50.5%. Let me go forward and now plot the decision boundary. So as you can clearly see, all the points have been classified as red points. So if you look at the background red signifies that the entire region has been classified as zero. So ideally, this entire classifier is not doing a good job as it's classifying every point to be a point of class zero. The reason why this is happening is we have chosen a very low value of gamma, indicating that there is a large similarity radius which results in more points being clubbed together. Let's now go forward and look at the next classifier with a higher value of gamma. I'll repeat the entire exercise again. I'll first create a classifier and then plot the decision boundary. So let me now create a classifier with the gamma value 0.01. Let me now go forward and plot the decision boundary. So if you look closely, nothing has changed at this point of time. Let's go forward. Let's now try our luck with a higher gamma value, which is 0.1. So let me run the cell. I see some accuracy increase here. The training accuracy has shot up from 50% to close to 80%. Let me go forward and plot the decision boundary now. So I can clearly see a definite decision boundary being created here. This region is the entire green region where all the points would be classified as class 1. This region is the red region where all the points would be classified as class 0. I can see good amount of misclassification as well here, but it's still better as compared to what we had initially. Let's now go forward. Now, the next thing that I'll create is I'll create a classifier with gamma equal to 1. Just to give you context, so far I've kept the C value to be equal to 1. So I've not played around with the C value. I'm just tweaking around with gamma, keeping C constant so that I can show you the impact that gamma has over the overall model that we have. Now when I look at this number, I'm really mesmerized. I can see a training accuracy of close to 93%. Let me go forward and plot the decision boundary now. So as you can clearly see, the green boundary is shifted towards the left now. So there are less amount of misclassifications happening from green to red. So yeah, this is a much better classifier as compared to the others that we've seen so far. The reason why this is happening is as we are increasing the gamma value, the similarity radius between points is kind of decreasing. Thus, not every point is being grouped into one group. So there are two definite groups being formed as I keep on increasing the gamma value. If this idea is clear to you, let's jump and understand the impact that C has over our SVM model. So let's go forward. Now that I've shown you what gamma essentially means in support vector machine, let's take the discussion forward and talk about C, the next hyperparameter. Now, if you recollect, the problem that SVM tries to address is kind of contradictory. If we start increasing the margin, then we'll end up having a higher misclassification rate. On the other hand, if we decrease the margin, we'll end up with a lower misclassification rate. So what is the right value to choose? It is here that C comes into picture. So C is essentially the parameter that adds penalty for each misclassified data point. If my C value is small, then essentially the penalty for misclassified points is also small, thus resulting in a larger margin-based boundary. However, if C is large, then SVM tries to minimize the number of misclassified examples due to the higher penalty on each point, and thus resulting in a decision boundary with a smaller margin. If this idea is clear, let's jump back to the coding section and see how an impact is created by changing the C values. So let me unhide the cell. So for the next set of examples, I'll keep the gamma constant and I'll play around with the C value. So let me go forward and create my next classifier with gamma equal to 0.1 and C equal to 0.1. If you recollect, having a lower value of C essentially gives lower weightage to the misclassified point. So let me go forward and plot the decision boundary. While that is being plotted, our training accuracy is close to 60%. So as you can clearly see, with a gamma value of 0.1 and with C value of 0.1, this is the decision boundary that we've generated. So the classifier is okay with all the misclassified points because we've not given a higher weightage to misclassification. So we have a large margin in this case, but our misclassification rate is very high. Let's go forward and increase the value of C. So now what I'll do next is I'll increase the value of C from 0.1 to 1. So let me run the cell. Wow, the training accuracy shot up from 60% to close to 80%. Let me now go forward and plot the decision boundary. Now, since we've increased the value of C, we are giving more weightage to the misclassified points. That is why we are able to reach at a higher accuracy number. In this case, the margin would have reduced, but our overall accuracy has increased because of the small tweak that we have done to the C parameter. Let's go forward. Let me now go forward and unhide the cell. The last piece in the puzzle is what I want to show you right now, wherein again the gamma value is 0.1 and I increase the C value from 1 to 10. So let me go forward and run the cell. The training accuracy has increased from 80 to 94%. Remember, I'm talking about training accuracy and not testing accuracy. So if you increase the value of C to a very higher extent, then there are chances that your model would be overfitting as well. Let me now go forward and plot the decision boundary for this classifier. So let me run the cell. So as you can clearly see, there is very little misclassification happening here. Most of the red points lie in the red region. Most of the green points lie in the green region. The reason why this is happening is because we have given higher weightage to every misclassification that happens while the training is going on. Out of all the advantages that we are seeing here, the only disadvantage is the margin has shrunk greatly. So there are chances that we've created a model that is an overfitted model. So all you have to do in order to use these hyperparameters better is you have to use hyperparameter tuning. You have to pick and choose the right combination of hyperparameters in order to create the best possible classifier for your particular data set. So this is a small video that I had in mind in order to explain how hyperparameters play a role in support vector machine. I hope you enjoyed this video. If you do like the work that I do on my channel, it would be super motivating if you can press the subscribe button and also press the bell icon to be notified for amazing videos on data science and machine learning. Thank you so much for watching this video.